I think mine is fine. Yeah, I think that's good.
Okay. Before you start the music, I just want to say that if I were going to write a love letter to God, this song would be it.
What can I say? we have a guest speaker, and I'm not sure why it says guest here, because Willie is and his family are family. They're not guests. In fact, we've already requested their transfer to our church. So I will turn this over to Willie.
Good morning. I don't know about you guys, but that song always gets me. There's something about his love and his grace. I hope your week was well. Mine was pretty good. Desire of Ages, page 22, paragraph 1. It says, the earth was dark through misapprehension of God, that the gloomy shadows might be lightened, that the world might be brought back to God, Satan's deceptive power was to be broken. This could not be done by force. The exercise of force is contrary to the principles of God's government. He desires only the service of love, and love cannot be commanded. It cannot be won by force or authority. Only by love is love awakened. To know God is to love him. His character must be manifested in contrast to the character of Satan. This work, only one being in all the universe could do. Only he who knew the height and depth of the love of God could make it known. Upon the world's dark night, the Son of Righteousness must rise with healing in his wings. We serve a great God. I started thinking about this little small series on our relationship to God on one of our trips to Florida. And I overheard one of my family members make this statement. God doesn't make sense. I mean, at least he doesn't make sense to me. And as I thought about what he said, a question came into my mind. We serve a creative God, don't we not? A God who speaks things into existence, and when he speaks, it happens. So he's very creative. And I thought, what if God uses our senses to reveal himself to us? So I meditated about God's creative ability. Take our bodies, for instance. There are 7 major systems in our bodies. We have the skeletal system, which are bones, which provide the body with shape and give protection to our organs. We have the muscular system. Working in very close connection with the skeletal system, they control the body, giving it strength and movement. We have the digestive system, breaking down foods into different proteins, vitamins, minerals, carbohydrates, fats, everything that our body needs. We have the respiratory system, which brings air, supplies our lungs with oxygen and gives it to the blood, and it generates just life to the cells. We have the circulatory system, which moves blood, carrying oxygen and nutrients supplied by the respiratory and the circulatory system to all parts of the body. We have the nervous system. It's our body's control system, sending, receiving, processing data 24/7. We have the reproductive system, allowing for the birth of offspring. Now, there are also a number of smaller yet very important systems as well. The lymphatic system, it's made up of a large network of vessels, lymph nodes, lymphatic organs, and tissues, and it's right around this section and carries through. We have the endocrine system, which is the chemical messenger system comprising of feedback full of hormones released by the internal glands of the organisms directly into the circulatory system. And we have the urinary system, or renal system, which bases the kidneys, ureters, bladders, and the urethra. When it's used basically to eliminate waste from the body, regulates the blood pH. Now, all of these systems grow and mature in us from conception. It is a miracle that all these systems can work together, but more than that, it is proof that there is a master designer whom we know as God. It's no wonder the psalmist declares in 139th chapter, verses 13 through 16, "Thou hast covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and my soul knoweth right well. My substance was not hid from thee when I was made in secret and curiously wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Thine eyes did see my substance, yet being unperfect. And in thy book all my members were written, which in continuance were fashioned when as yet there was none of them." And if that was not enough, the Lord also gave us 5 senses to help us. To help us interact with people and to help us interact with the world around us. Hearing, sight, smell, taste, and touch. Each of these give us a different perspective on our world. And as I thought about this, my mind shifted to my friend Brian. Brian has a little daughter that when she was born, shortly thereafter, she contracted German measles. And as a result of her contracting this disease, she ended up legally blind and deaf. And when I first met her, she was about 7 or 8 years old. And Anna remembers how she called me old man. She would go like this, that I was an old man. And I was curious, what is she saying? I could not communicate with her because I didn't know how she communicated. I also think of my friend Eddie, who died in 2013, and he was deaf in one ear. So if I was standing on a specific side, he struggled to hear me clearly. So I can't even imagine how difficult it must be to be without one or without more than one of these senses. How often does God speak to us about our relationship to Him in terms that are reminiscent of our senses? Today, as we go through our study this morning, we will focus on one of these. We're going to focus on hearing. This brings us to our opening passage for this morning. Turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Hebrews, chapter 3, and we're going to read verses 6 through 8. Hebrews chapter 3, verses 6 through 8. It says, "But Christ, as a son over his own house, whose house are we, if we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope firm unto the end, wherefore, as the Holy Ghost saith," what's the next word? "Today, if you will," what? "Hear his voice, harden not your hearts as in the provocation, in the day of temptation in the wilderness." This verse is making reference to Psalms 95. "For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand. Today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts." Friends, hearing is important for a number of reasons. And as we attempt to go through this study this morning, we're going to analyze 3 aspects of hearing. 1, hearing is essential to salvation. What did I say? Hearing is necessary for obedience. And lastly, hearing is foundational for hope. It got better at the end, more energy. And as we look into his gracious word this morning, I pray that we will hold firm the words that are found in Matthew chapter 15 and verse 10, which says, "And he called the multitude and said unto them, Hear and understand." Now, hearing is so important that 16 times from the book of Matthew to Revelation, we hear the words, "Let him hear." Why? Because hearing is essential to salvation. Point number one. As Jesus went about his ministering to the public, we have recorded for us in the book of Matthew what has become to be known as the kingdom parable, Matthew chapter 13. And at one point, he made this statement to his disciples. We find this in Matthew chapter 13 and verse 15. "For this people's heart is waxed gross, and their ears are dull of hearing, and their eyes they have closed, lest at any time they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and should understand within their heart and should be converted, and I should heal them." The people were dead, so to speak, and could not hear the words of the Lord, not the act of physical hearing, but we're dealing here with spiritual hearing. And so it would take a miracle for them to hear. Friends, and we are no different today. Our ears are dull of hearing. How many times have you heard John 3:16? How many times have you heard Revelation 3 and verse 20? Sometimes our ears become dull of hearing the same thing over and over and over, and we become numb to it. It's called desensitization. We are desensitized. And sometimes it takes a miracle to allow us to hear again. Why is it so hard? Maybe someone who is dead in their sin, they need a special hearing. They need the special call of God to their ear. It is the hearing of the word, more specifically the gospel, that we need. Paul, as he writes the great treatise of faith in the book of Romans, he states in Romans chapter 10 and verse 17, "So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God." Now, these words spoken right in the heels of the greatest passage in the scriptures, Romans 10, 6 through 10, which states, "But the righteousness which is of faith speaketh on this wise, say not in your heart, who shall ascend into heaven, or who shall descend into the deep? But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even thy mouth, and in thy heart," that is, the word of faith which we preach, "that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved." Verse 10, "For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation." How can we be dead in our hearing? Because we hear, but then we don't confess. So I'm urging you this morning, friends, don't just hear the word of God. Confess the word of God to all those around you. Amen. If you have heard and if you have believed, then you must confess. We must express what God has done to us. We must share with others how good he is. What does John 3:16 mean? What does Revelation 3:20 mean when he says, "I stand at the door and knock"? What door? One must hear the gospel and thereby accept it by faith, believing the very word of God. Friends, Jesus died for our sins, your sins, my sins. Yes, we are sinners. For Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." And because we are sinners, we are bound for death. For the wages of sin is death, Romans 6:23. So unless you come to Christ as your Savior, you have no hope. If therefore you are hearing this word and the Holy Spirit is tugging at your heart, do not delay. Do not delay. Come to the Lord now while he may be found. Acts chapter 3 and verse 19. Acts chapter 3 and verse 19 says, "Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord." So I ask you this morning, how is your sense of hearing? Friends, hearing is essential to salvation. Point number two. Hearing is necessary for obedience. I remember that as a child, my mom would ask me to do certain things, and I don't know if I was deaf or pretty stubborn, but I know I got a lot of whippings when I was little. Sometimes I just didn't hear her. I really didn't. She's laughing with me, not at me. Consequently, the same thing happens now with my wife. Now, I know what you're all thinking. Did you not hear her, or did you ignore her? Now, I probably ignored my mom sometimes, but my wife, I should know better. But to my defense, it is really hard to obey if you do not hear. Sweetheart, take out the trash. But if you don't hear that, how are you going to obey? Hearing is necessary for obedience. God wants us to hear him unto obedience. Listen to these words found in the book of Mark, chapter 4, verses 20 and then 23 through 25. Mark chapter 4, 20, 23 through 25. It says, "And these are they which are sown on good ground, such as hear the word and receive it and bring forth fruit, some 30-fold, some 60, and some 100. Verse 23, "If any man have ears to hear, let him hear. And he said unto them, Take heed what ye hear. With what measure ye meet, it shall be measured to you, and unto you that hear shall more be given. For he that hath, to him shall be given, and he that hath not, from him it shall be taken, even that which he hath." Why? Because he heard, and he didn't obey. When we hear, we become responsible for the word. Now it's a matter of obedience. You done heard the word. Over and over again in the book of Revelation, chapter 2 and 3, we read the words that he hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit has to say unto the churches. And in the future, we will prepare specific cases on each church so that you would understand what all the seven churches are. He is speaking about listening to and acting upon in obedience that which he had warned the church, such as we find in Revelation 2, verses 4 and 5, which says, "Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and I will remove thy candlestick out of this place, except thou repent." Is it necessary that we listen to our Lord and hear what he is saying to us? Is it necessary for us not only to hear, but then to obey what he's saying? Has he not proven to us time and time again, and has he not given us evidence of how good a God he is? I think so. At least to me, he has. May 24th of 2018, came home from work, and I used to mow the church in Orange, Virginia. So I grabbed my little push mower, and I went to mow the church. Came home around 6:45 or so, 6:30, and I felt like I had allergies. So I sat, took a Benadryl, sat down in the living room, And my wife says, "You're having a heart attack." I said, "No, I'm not. I'm not having no heart attack." She called my mom, and my mom says, "Sweetheart, go to the hospital." "Mom, I ain't going to the hospital. I'm not going to get a doctor bill for it. I'm not having a heart attack. These are allergies. It'll go away." Symptoms got worse. I started feeling this weirdness under my armpits, and I started feeling this numbness in my fingers, and then all of a sudden I started feeling my jaw was like locked jaw. And my wife rushed and got cayenne extract. Took a whole dropperful. Now, if you all know what cayenne is, it is spicy and it burns. So, of course, me in the middle of a heart attack, which I didn't think I was having, now I'm complaining and murmuring why this thing is so hot in my mouth. Next thing I know, there's a paramedic and there's an EKG going on. And next thing I know, he grabs that little thingamajiggy in his ambulance and he says, "This is Madison emergency. Call him Pegasus." Now, Pegasus is a flying horse, right? But in Virginia, it's a helicopter. And I said, "Why are you calling the helicopter?" He said, "Because we're not going to make it." What if I had not listened? What if I had listened to my wife? Maybe an hour earlier, I would have probably been at the hospital and wouldn't have been so bad. I am alive. Don't get me wrong. I'm alive. That's a good thing. I would have been alive anyways, because if I would have gone earlier, they would have caught it even faster. But what I'm complaining about is I ended up with a $140,000 doctor bill, $30,000 of which was a helicopter ride that I didn't even enjoy. Is it important to listen? Yes. She has proven to me time and time again her love for me. I mean, we're going on 25 years married. Why didn't I want to listen to her? And we are no different with the Lord. One last thought on this issue. James chapter 1 and verse 22. James chapter 1 and verse 22. Now, if you consider, this is a little side note. If you consider yourself an Adventist in the end times, the book of James is like a manual for Adventists in the end times. Study and read the book of James. James chapter 1, verse 22 says, "But be ye," what?
Doers
of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. So what he's saying is that if you are just a hearer of the word and not a doer, you're only deceiving yourself because you're claiming to be something that you're really not. Hearing is necessary, but there must be obedient action following the reception of God's word. If we do not follow through on the hearing, we're only deceiving ourselves concerning our life in Christ our God. The Pharisees heard, but they were deceived and did not obey it. Why may we be hearing and not obeying? Worldliness, anger, pride, selfishness, fill in the blank. We all have our blanks. And each blank that goes thereafter may be different. Help us, Lord, to do some introspective analysis on ourselves so that we won't deceive us. How is your sense of hearing this morning? One last thing we need to consider concerning our hearing. Hearing is essential for hope. It's foundational. If you read the book of Acts, you will come to see that those who did not hear the words of God had no hope. They were constantly looking for something else, somewhere else. The Sanhedrin was trying to find hope in a Messiah of their own making who was not coming. The populace was trying to find hope in the government that was increasingly corrupt and crumbling. The religious crowd outside of Judea was trying to find hope in gods, again, of their own making, who were unable to help them. Matthew chapter 9 and verse 36, we read of a situation that involved Jesus and the masses that were all around him. It says, but when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion on them because they fainted and were scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd. Now I have sheep at home, and Mia is the main shepherdess. But sometimes when I come and I feed them for a few days, it's like they get used to me, and the moment I come, they run. So my father-in-law brought this big dog from Miami. Her name is Muñeca. When she lived in Miami, her name was Muñeca, but now she lives in Jasper, so her name is Dolly. And a few Sundays ago, I let her out, and she was running around, and as I go towards the sheep, they were scared of this big old mean dog that they had never seen, and they ran to me. They saw protection. It's like they come to your legs, and they come around you, and they try to put me between the dog and them. Oh, that we would do that with the Lord. Because there is a raging lion seeking whom he may devour. And we need our protector. We need an omnipotent, omniscient God that can save us from this lion. And it was Paul who wrote in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 12, that at any time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope, and without God in the world. It is through hearing the word of God that hope can be found. John records in John chapter 5 and verse 25, verily, verily, I say unto you, the hour is coming and now is, when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they that hear shall live. Amen. Amen. You don't have to be physically dead to hear and be resurrected when the Messiah calls. But you can be spiritually dead, walking around this earth. And we all need to be able to hear his words of love calling to our hearts. Life with Jesus is a life that will be filled with hope. Now, I'm not sure where you are this morning. I'm not sure what you were dealt with in 2020. I'm not sure what you were dealt with in 2021, and we still have 3 more weeks of it. But I can tell you that in Christ, there is hope. Jesus is our hope, and the hearing of his word assures us of this. Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 19 says, which hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast. Beyond this, there is the hope of eternity with the Lord. Now, I'm 48. But I still think of heaven, and I still think that I want to run with lions. And I want to play with elephants and giraffes, and I want to go swimming with dolphins. This is not just for kids. I mean, I'm a kid. And I want to do these things. But this is what keeps my hope of perseverance going, hearing that what God has prepared for us, no eye has seen or no ear has heard. Jesus also said, marvel not at this, that which he has stated in verse 25, for the hour is coming in which all that are in the graves shall hear his voice. Friends, have you lost a loved one this year? There is hope. That when he calls, it's a miraculous calling, and they will hear. Those that hear his word have the promise of the resurrection. They have what I like to call the blessed hope. Hearing the word of God is foundational to our knowledge and understanding of this hope. Living in obedience to his word is necessary to experience this hope. So I ask you again this morning, how is your sense of hearing? God has given us 5 senses to relate to the world around us. He demonstrates his love for us using our senses. Does he make sense yet? I know he makes a lot of sense to me. These same senses are used often metaphorically to express our relationship to God. The writer of Hebrews quotes a passage from Psalms 95, which I want to use in our closing few minutes. If you're not sure of your relationship with God this morning, and the Lord has spoken, I pray that you will listen. Wherefore, as the Holy Ghost saith, today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts. Friends, our tomorrow is not sure. Why this sense of urgency? When was this written? How many years have passed since this was written? Why the sense of urgency? Why is there urgency in these words? In Sabbath school, we talked about Elijah. Was there not urgency in his words? It says, how long will you halt between two opinions? There's urgency there. Is there not urgency in these words? Today, if you will hear his voice. Why the urgency? We don't know when we will die. As I lay in that helicopter, I didn't know if I was going to die that day. And I'm strapped in there, can't move, can't look out at this nice scenery. And I said, Lord, I don't know if this is my day, but I know you love my family more than I do. Take care of them. But today is not my day. Please give me peace. And I tell you, that helicopter landed in 8 minutes at the University of Virginia. And there was 4 doctors waiting at the door. And the moment that paramedic, Matt Hughes, wheeled me into the hospital there, they said, is that Mr. Sanchez? They said, yes, we're waiting for him in the cath lab. I was wheeled into the cath lab. They strapped my hand down. They checked my artery. They said, yep, it's got good diameter. Let's go through here. It's faster. And I'm trying to watch on the TV what was going on. They go in there. The doctor said, you're going to get very nauseous. Do not puke on me. And I said, don't worry. I don't like to do that. And sure enough, I got very nauseous. You sweat profusely. And then they clean it out. And then they go back in and put the stent in there. And I felt perfectly great. By the time my wife got to the hospital, from our house to the hospital, it was about 45 minutes. They were already done. I was already in cardiac intensive care. I didn't know I was going to die that day. And we do not know if we're going to die today. Today is the accepted time. Today is the day of salvation. Behold, now is the accepted time. The Lord says in Revelation 3:20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and I will sup with him and he with me. Friends, how is your sense of hearing this morning? Hear him speaking to your heart? Is he calling on you to make a choice? Don't delay. Do not delay. Let us pray. Father in heaven, you are so gracious that you have given us today to live. But today is full of choices. And I pray that we may choose you above all other choices. Help us if we are weak in this choice. Give us of your strength, because you are the master workman and you are faithful to finish the work that you have begun. Be with every hearer this morning and give us the strength to obey, is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.